Hello everyone, we are currently at Unit 4, Part 1. We are currently at Lecture 8 of the course and we will talk about context-free grammars and context-free languages. We moved to Chapter 2 of the SIPSR book. You can also use as a book of the Hebrew University in Hebrew, of the Open University in Hebrew. And you can also use Hopcroft chapter 5. So we will talk about grammar, dikduk in Hebrew. Basically, DFA or NFA describes a regular language in a computational way. We have some word and we simulate a finite automaton on this input, on this word. After reading the word W and using the states of the automaton, we check where we stopped. If we stopped at the accepting state, we accept the word. If we stopped at the rejecting state, we reject the word. A regular expression is another method of describing languages in syntactic way. Additional syntactic way definition is grammar. A grammar is a set of rules describing languages in a syntactic way. We start with an empty word or an empty string and we use grammar rules until we have a desired output, our string. We add some letters at the beginning, some letters at the end, some letters in the middle, until we reach the desired output. And this process is called parsing. The origin of the grammar. The origin of the name grammar comes from natural languages. The word grammar was used before automata and formal languages. The word grammar is a collection of rules that every child studies during his school years. When we study linguistics, we usually study the rules that we can use to build sentences, to build words. The collection of rules defines what is legal in this language and what is not legal or does not belong to this language. So let's see an example of a grammar. We are given some alphabet, AB. We are given variables, V, S, and B. And we have a grammar rules, S derives AS, S derives B, B derives large B, small b, B derives epsilon, and I claim that the following grammar generates the language A star, B star. Let's see how I can build the sequence of A's. I will use the rule S derives AS. And from the second S, I will derive additional AS and additional AS. And I will derive as many A's as I want. Then I will move to B, S derives B. And then we will derive as many B as we want using the recursive rule, B derives large B, small b. And finally, when we want to stop, we will use the derivation B derives an empty word epsilon, and we will stop our computation. So let's see how I can derive an empty word. I will start with rule S derives large B, and then large B will derive epsilon. So I will have an empty word, an empty string. Let's see how I can derive AB. I will start with S derives AS. Then I will use the rule S derives B. And then from the B, I will derive BB. And later I will use B derives epsilon. and I will have the word AB. If we want to give a formal definition of the grammar, we will use the following words. We will have a list of terminals. Our alphabet, symbols of the alphabet, will be our terminals. We will have a set of variables, V, a finite set of other symbol, which represents some part or some structure of the language. We will have a start symbol S, which belongs to V, and it will be a start variable. From this variable, we will start derivation of all the words, and we will have a collection of production rules. The common notations for the terminal symbols are low cases of low alphabet. A, B, C, and it can also be digits 0, 1, and so on. Variables we write with upper cases of lower alphabet, like A, B, C once again. String of terminals we write in low case but higher alphabet. We will talk about string W, string V, U, X, Y. We are usually talking about strings. Mixed strings, terminals plus variables mixed together. We will write all lowercase Greek alphabet letters, alpha, beta, gamma, and so on. Starting variable, we usually will write S. Since we are using starting variable. Production rules will have left part, some arrow right part, and we will call the meaning of the production rule is alpha can be replaced by beta. Alpha constructs beta. Alpha produces beta. Alpha derives better. Let's see an example. Here we have an alphabet 0, 1. A set of variables has only one symbol, S. The language L is 0 in power of n, 1 in power of n, where n is greater than 0, so the empty word does not belong to the language. And the following grammar produces this language. S derives 0s1. For each 0 at the beginning of the word, we have 1 at the end of the word. And we can continue as many times as we like. So we will have 0 in power of n, 1 in power of n. And we will, when we want to finish, we will replace the S with production 01, and we will finish the parsing process. Let's see another example. We have an alphabet A, B, and D as sign, and we have the following grammar that will generate the language A in power of N, B in power of M, DS, B in power of M, A in power of n, m, n can be larger, greater, equal to 0. So we have the following grammar. S derives A, S, A. So for A at the beginning of the word, we have additional A at the end of the word. And if we will use this rule, we will produce A in power of n at the beginning and at the end. Then S will move to B, to new variable. The variable B will use the following rule, small b, large b, b. So for each b at the beginning of the word, we will add additional b at the end of the word. This rule, the third rule, will actually produce B in power of M and B in power of M. And when we want to finish this derivation, we will use B produces the ds sign, and we will finish the computation. So basically, we have the first rule is actually producing A in power of n at the beginning and at the end. The third rule produces B in power of m at the middle, before ds and after ds, and B produces ds is actually a middle sign that divides between AB and BA. Derivation of the word is the following process. We start from the start variable, starting symbol S. We find the variable A that is written down, and we use some rule A produces alpha. We replace A with alpha, and we continue with derivation process, repeat steps 2 and 3, until we have variables at the right part of the derivation, and we stop the derivation of the word where we have only terminals written down. We will use double arrow notation to present an actual derivation. A double arrow, alpha double arrow derives beta. It means that the string beta was derived from alpha using a production rule. We can derive some prefix alpha A suffix beta derives alpha gamma beta if A derives gamma. So we just replace the variable A with the right side of the derivation with gamma. Let's see an example. S derives 0, 1. S derives 0, S, 1. So we start from starting variable S. We use the first rule, and we replace S with 0, S, 1. Then we can continue, and we can replace the S once again with 0, S, 1. And we will once again use the derivation that from S we can derive 0, 1 without the S. Now we have only terminal symbols, and we stop the derivation. The resulting, the produced word is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. Let's see how we can produce the word WAACB using the following grammar. The grammar is S derives AS, S derives BS, S derives CS, S derives epsilon. This grammar can be rewritten as S derives AS, or BS, or CS, or epsilon. It can be written in one line. So, how do I produce the word AACB? Once again, I start with start variable S. And since the first letter of the word W is A, I will use the first rule, and I will replace S with AS. So we will have AS. Since the second letter of W is A, I will use the first rule once more, and I will replace S with AS, and we will have AAS as a current string. Now I see that the next letter in the input is C. So I will use the third rule, and I will replace S with CS. So we will have AACS. I will see that the next input letter is B. I will use the second rule, and I will replace S with BS, and I will have AACBS. Now I actually see the final word. So what I need is just to delete S. I can't delete S, so I will use the fourth rule and I will use the production S derives an empty word. And I will replace S with an empty word. And I will have the required word AACB. The same process can be presented with the parsing tree. So let's talk about a little bit about parsing. Producing a word according to a given grammar is called parsing. We can represent the same production sequence by a parsing tree. So we will definitely build the tree. We will start with the root, which will be the starting symbol, and then we will use a production rule as the children of the node of the tree. So each node in the tree will be either a variable or a terminal. A terminal node is a leaf and we can't continue anymore. The variable can be replaced later by its children, which will be the right hand of some production rule. The resulting word is a concatenation of all the leaves from left to right, and this is called yield of the parsing tree. So let's use the previous word and the previous grammar as an example. We have a word W, which is AACB, and now we will build a parsing tree using the same rules that we did before. Here you see the resulting parsing tree, but now I will do all the whole process in steps. We start with S, and we replace S with AS since the first letter of in our word W is A. Then we are taking S at the second level, and since the next letter of the input is once again A, we replace A with AS. The next letter is C, so we will replace S with CS, and we will have A as a leaf, A as a leaf, C as a leaf, and S as a node. The next letter in the input is B. We will use the rule S derives BS, and we will replace or we will produce the BS part. And now we generally have our result, our word. So we just want to delete S and we will replace S with the epsilon. We will use the four. So after we replace S with epsilon, we have as the leaves our resulting word AACB. And this word is produced by our parsing tree. Contents-free grammar in Hebrew Dikduk Haser Ekshar or Dikduk Chofshi Ekshar. Contents-free grammar, CFG, is a four-tuple G, V, sigma, S, R, where V is a finite set of the variables, sigma is a finite set disjoint from V called the set of terminals. S belongs to V is a start symbol. R is a finite set of the production rule of the form. We have left side arrow right side. At the left side we have only one variable. At the right side we have V union of sigma. Star at the right star at the right hand side of the rule, we can have a mixture of variables and terminal symbols together. Let's talk about derivation process in context-free grammar. Let alpha, beta, and gamma be strings of variables and terminals. If alpha derives gamma is a rule in the grammar, we say that alpha A beta derives alpha gamma beta, since we have a rule A derives gamma. And it can be written as alpha A beta produces, derives alpha gamma beta. We can write X derives star Y if there is exist a sequence of steps that we can move from X to X1 to X2 to X3 until we reach Y. The meaning of different notations. Double error notation means derives in one step. Double error notation with plus means derives in one or more steps, but definitely one step. Double error notation with the star means derives in zero or more steps. Okay, since we are talking about languages, let's talk about context-free language. The language of the grammar, L of G, is a set of words over alphabet sigma star, such that the word W can be derived from the starting symbol of the grammar. So basically we can write LG equals to W that belongs to sigma star, such as S derives W in zero or more steps. The language generated by context-free grammar is called context-free language, CFL. Okay, so let's see some examples. We are talking about sigma 01, and we would like to construct a grammar for the following language. L has three words in it, 0, 0, 0, and 1. So we will build four tuple. We will start with V, and the set V of the variables will have only one variable, S, which will be also the start variable. The alphabet will be 0, 1, it was given to us. And R, the set of production rules, will be the following one. S derives 0, the first word. S divides zero, derives 0, 0, the second string at the language. S derives 1. We can write it in simplified way. S derives 0, O, 0, 0, O, 1. And here we have a grammar that derives only three words. So we have a finite language, and we have the derivation of each word as additional rule. Okay, let's see another example over alphabet 01. We would like to construct a grammar for the language 0 in power of n, 1 in power of n, where n greater equals to 0. So I encourage you to stop the lecture and to try to solve this question by yourself. But basically, the idea is the following idea. For each 0 that I add at the beginning, I would like to add additional 1 at the end. So for each 0 in the prefix, I would like to add 1 in the suffix. So that's what I will actually write in my grammar. Additional question, do we have an empty word belonging to the language? Since n can be equal to 0, empty word belongs to the language. So we will write the solution, the resulting grammar. The resulting grammar will be four tuple. The set of the variable will consist of S. The alphabet will be 0, 1. The start variable will be S. And the set of rules R will be S derives 0, S1 For 0 at the beginning of the word, we have 1 at the end, and S derives epsilon. Let's see an example how we can parse the word 0011. We will start with S, and we will use the first production rule. We will replace S with 0S1. We will use the same rule once more. We will replace S with 0S1. And now we actually have the resulting word. We just want to delete S. So we will use the production rule S derives epsilon, and we will have 0011 as the resulting output. Additional example, we would like to construct the grammar for the following language. L equals 0 in power of n, 1 in power of n, where n is greater equals to 1. So once again, I encourage you to solve this question by yourself. Please pay attention that we don't have an empty string belonging to the language anymore. So basically, if I would like to write the solution for this question, the solution will be the previous solution, but instead of the empty word, we will derive 0, 1. So our production rules will be S derives 0, S1, S derives 0, 1, and if I would like to parse the word 4 zeros, 4 ones, I will use 3 times the rule S derives 0S1. So I will produce the first 0, the second 0, the third 0, and 3 ones in the end. And then the fourth time, we will use the rule S derives 0, 1. And we will replace the last S with 0, 1. And we will have the word 4 zeros, 4 ones written down. Okay, additional example. We would like to construct a grammar for the following language. L equals to 0 in power of n, 1 in power of m, where m is greater equal to n, and n is greater than 0. So we definitely would like to have the number of ones larger, greater than the number of 0. The number of 0 in prefix shouldn't be 0, so we will have at least 1 0. Then we will have additional zeros, and for each 0 we will have 1 that equals to this 0, and maybe we can derive additional ones since m can be greater than n. So please, once again, I encourage you to stop the recording and to try to solve this question by yourself. Our result will be the following result. S will be 2 variables, S and B, where S will be the start variable. The alphabet will be 0, 1. And R, the set of production rules, will have the following rules. S derives 0, S, 1. So for each 0, we will have 1. So we will have the number of zeros that equals to the number of ones. And then we will use the rule S derives 0B1, and we will move to B. In B, we can add additional ones by using the rule B derives B1, or we can decide to finish the production, and we can decide to use the rule B derives epsilon and to stop the derivation of the word. Okay, another example. We have a regular language L, which is actually represented by a regular expression 0 star 1 plus. Once again, I encourage you to solve this question by yourself. Please pay attention that we don't have any definition of how many zeros should we have or how many ones should we have or any relation between zero and one. So we can produce as many zeros as we want, including zero zeros, and then we will definitely produce one one and maybe additional ones. So we will use the following grammar. S derives 0s, so we will have 0 as much as we want. If we don't want any zeros, we can use the rule S derives 1b, and we definitely have 1, 1. And then from b, a variable, we can derive additional ones by using the rule b derives 1b, or we can use the rule, the production rule b derives epsilon, and we can stop the production of the input. Okay, let's think what should we do if we would like to build a grammar for 0 star 1 star. So now we don't definitely want additional 1. We can have also 0 ones in our string. So instead of writing the second rule S derives 1b, S will derive only b without 1. When we move to b, we can derive epsilon and we can stop producing words. Or we can derive 1b and we can produce as many, or we can add as many ones as we want. So the change is actually a small change. Okay, additional example. We would like to construct a grammar for the following language. L equals to 0 in power of 2i plus 1, where I greater equals to 0. So I encourage you to solve this question once again by yourself. Okay, let's analyze this language. In this language, I would like to have two zeros as many times as I want. And each time I add two zeros, it will be I, the next I. So we definitely will have 0 in power of 2i. And when I would like to finish the derivation, I will use the single 0, and that will be plus 1 that we see here. So let's see the resulting grammar. The resulting grammar will be S derives 0, 0s, and I can use this rule as many times as I want. And then S derives a single 0, and this 0 is plus 1 that we see in the definition of the language. Additional solutions that can be given. S derives 0s0. So for 0 at the end, at the beginning we have 0 at the end. And S derives 0 will be the last rule. So it will be plus 1 that we saw before. Okay, additional example. I would like to construct a grammar for the following language. L equals to 0 in power of I plus 1, 1 in power of I, where I can be greater or equal to 0. So once again, I encourage you to solve this question by yourself. Now let's start solving this question together. So for each 0 in the prefix, I would like to have 1 in the suffix. It will be 0 in power of I, 1 in power of I. But I would like to finish the process with single 0. It will be a plus 1 at 0. So I will write the following grammar. S derives 0 as 1, or s derives 0. So 0 s 1 will add for each 0 at the prefix, 1 at the suffix. It will be 0 in power of I, 1 in power of I. And when we would like to finish the process, we will only add 1 0 and we will have plus 1 that is written at the language. Let's see additional example. We have a lot of examples today. You were asked to construct a grammar for the following language. L equals to all the words W, that the length of W modulo 2 equals 1. So we are talking about all odd length words over alphabet 0, 1. So basically it's relatively simple. We add two letters to finish, to end the process. We would like to add a single letter. And the letters can be 0 of 1 or 1, it doesn't matter. So once again, I encourage you to solve this question by yourself. And now we will start to solve it together. Let's see. The grammar will be G, where variables will have S, alphabet 0, 1, and production rules will be the following one. S derives single 0 or single 1 to have an odd length. S derives 1 S 1. I added 1 at the beginning and 1 at the end. S derives 0 S 0 to have zeros at the beginning and at the end. S derives 1 S 0, 1 at the beginning, 0 at the end. And additional combination, S derives 0 as 1, so we have 0 at the beginning and 1 at the end. So let's parse 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1. I will use the following algorithm. I will see what is the first and the last letter, and I see it's 0, 1, so I will use the last rule. S derives 0 as 1. So we have 0 and 1. The second letter in prefix and the second letter from the end of the suffix is 1, 0. So I will use the rule S derives 1 as 0 and I will derive 1, 0. The third letter in prefix is 1. The third letter from the end of the suffix is 1. So I will use the rule S derives 1 S 1, and I will move to the fourth letter. The first letter from the beginning is 1, the first letter from the end is 0, so I will use the production rule S derives 1 S 0, and then I have the single 0, so I will use the rule S derives 0. Alternative grammar for this language can be S derives D S D or D, where D represents digit, any digit, 0 or 1. So I have digit at the beginning, digit at the end, two digits, and I continue with two digits. And then I have S deriving the single digit, and it doesn't matter what is which digit I saw. 1, 0, 0, with two zeros, zeros at the beginning and then the end, ones, whatever. Additional solution can be S derives DDS or D, S derives digit, digit, S or digit, where digit derives 0 or 1. So I have two digits, recursion with S, two digit, recursion with S. When I would like to finish, I use the single digit and I will have odd length input. Okay, additional example. We would like to construct a grammar for the following language. And the language is actually the union of two languages. L is the union of 0 in power of n, 1 in power of n, where n is greater than 0, or one in power of n, zero in power of n, where n is greater or equal to zero. So basically the idea will be to write all the production rules for the first grammar, for the first language, to write all the production rules for the second language, and then to have the starting symbol moving to the starting symbol of the first language or to the starting symbol of the second language. So let's solve this question together. So we have the following grammar, and I will talk about grammar rules. I claim that from variable A, I derive the first part of the language, 0 in power of n, 1 in power of n. So A can be replaced with 0a1, 0 at the beginning, 1 at the end, and I can continue with this rule as many times as I want. And then I produce 0, 1. So we definitely have n larger than 0. I claim that the variable b produces the second language. B produces 1, b, 0. So for each one in prefix, we will have 0 in suffix. And then b produces an empty word. So we definitely have a possibility of n equals to zero. And then we use the starting variable s to choose where to go, or to go to the starting variable of the first language, a, or s goes to the starting variable of the second language, b. So we definitely have a grammar for the union written here. Here you can see the set of exercises that we will solve during our Zoom meeting. So we will solve them together. So in previous examples, we had a definition of the language and we were asked to produce the grammar. Now we are giving the different direction. We are giving the grammar, and we would like to get a description of the language of the grammar. So we have to define the language for a context-free grammar. So you have the, here we have the grammar S derives 0 as 0 or 1. Please try to solve this question by yourself. I will solve this question together with you in a moment. Okay, so the language of G is 0 in power of n, 1, 0 in power of n. For each 0 in the prefix, we have 0 in the suffix. This is 0 in power of n. And to stop, we are using the rule S derives 1, and it is the single 1 deriving between the zeros. Okay. Additional grammar, and once again, we have to define the language for a context-free grammar. The grammar is S derives 0 as 0, or 1 as 1, or epsilon. So for each 0 at the beginning, we have 0 at the end. For each 1 at the beginning, we have 1 at the end. And when we want to finish, we have an epsilon. So try to define the language. I will do it in a moment. The resulting language of this grammar is the language of all words that W equals to W reverse, and the length of W is even, since for each 0 or 1 we added additional 0 or 1. So here we're actually talking about even length palindrome. This grammar defines all the palindromes of the even length over alphabet 0, 1. Now we are given additional grammar And we have two additional rules. S can now derive single 1 and single 0 and once again epsilon. So when we add these two rules, we actually changed the definition of the language. Now we don't have an even length words, we have all the words. So LG is the language of all words over alphabet 0, 1, where W equals to W reverse. W equals to W reverse is also called palindrome. Additional example. We are giving the following grammar. S derives 0A, 0B. A can derive 1 and return to S. And once again, we will have 0A1S. And if we decide to go to B, we derive a single 1 and stop the derivation. So try to think how you define the language for this context-free grammar. Okay, the resulting language will be 0, 1 in power of n. Since we have S, 0, A, A, 1, S, so we have 0, 1 combination, and we can continue with this combination as many times as we want. And when we want to finish, we have S derives 0, B, and B derives a single 1. We can't derive an empty word here, so our N is definitely greater equal to 1. Okay, the simpler version can be S derives 0, 1, S. And we can derive 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1 as many times as we want. And when we want to finish, we use the rule S derives 0, 1, and we finish the production. New grammar, the same question. Define the language for a given context-free grammar. The grammar is S derives 0, S, 1, 1, and to finish, we derive a single 0. So try to solve this question by yourself. The resulting language is 0 in power of n plus 1, 1 in power of 2n. Since for each 0 we added 2 ones, so for each 0 in power of n we have 1 in power of 2n, and when we finish we use a single 0. Okay, we're given a little bit more complex definition of the grammar. S derives E, O, N, E. N derives D, D, N. D can be digit from 0 till 7. E can be digits 0, 2, 4, 6. So I definitely see that all the words end with E. And I definitely see that we have base 8 alphabet. So try to define the language of a context-free grammar by yourself. I will give you an answer in a moment. Okay, the language that we see here, we have all W, where W represents an even octal number. We have an alphabet from 0 to 7, which is called octal alphabet. And we definitely have words ending with E, only even digits. So we have even octal numbers written using this grammar. Okay, let's see additional example. We are giving a grammar S derives N dot N or minus N dot N. N derives D or dn, and d can be from 0 till 9. Please try to think what is defined here, and please try to give the definition of the language. Okay, the resulting language, the language of the g, is the language of all words w, where w represents a decimal rational number, the number with dot. The number can be positive or negative, since we can see the minus sign. And we are using decimal alphabet since the digits are all over alphabet 0, 1 till 9. Here we have a set of exercises that we will do during our practice Zoom meeting. Let's see additional exercise. We are giving a context-free grammar, and we have not over alphabet A, over alphabet 0, 1, 2 till 9 with plus and multiplication. And we are asked to parse the string 3 plus 4 multiplied by 5. Okay. We have two possibilities. The starting variable is E. And we can derive as the first step E plus E or E multiplication E. And we definitely can build two different parsing trees. Let's see in a moment the resulting parsing trees. Okay, the left parsing tree actually computes the correct result. We first produce 4 multiplied by 5 and then add 3, and we will have 23 as a result. And if we will use the right parsing tree, we will have 3 plus 4, which is 7, multiplied by 5, and the result will be 35, which is not a correct result for this expression. So, if we can manage to build two different parsing trees, we have an ambiguous grammar and we have an ambiguous production. And the problem in this grammar is that we have no precedence of multiplication over the addition. So we have two results, 23, a correct result, and 35, incorrect result. And we actually don't know what will be the result since two parsing trees are legit parsing trees for this grammar. Basically, ambiguity of the grammar is the possibility to generate the same string using several different trees or several different ways, and it calls ambiguity. A grammar is ambiguous if there exists a string W that can be derived by at least two different parse trees. Sometimes it is possible to rewrite the grammar and to find unambiguous grammar equals to our grammar, but sometimes it is impossible because some context-free languages are inherently ambiguous. Let's see an example of the language A in power of I, B in power of J, C in power of K, where O I equals to J or J equals to K. Another example of ambiguous grammar is the grammar that we have here. And we will solve this question also during the class. And the question is, which symbols are terminals here? How can we parse the string 3 plus 4 multiplied by 5? Do we have a single parsing tree or do we have several possibilities? How can we parse the string brackets 3 plus 4 multiplied by 5? We will solve all those, we will answer all those questions during the practice exam. That's it for today. We finished with the first part of the unit 7. We will meet during Zoom practice meeting and we will solve some questions together. And next week we will continue talking about grammars